As always, let's first take a look at our favorite spaceship over at Boca Chica. How is Starship SN4 progressing? And will SpaceX have enough revenue to just keep pumping out Starships? Then the relationship between the US and Russia is at a low point, with Russia having performed an anti-satellite missile test, and the chief of Roscosmos sharply attacking SpaceX.
Believe it or not, Roscosmos's remarks are even topped by ULA. Apparently, Roscosmos and the ULA are engaged in a fierce competition who can say stupider stuff. And we also have some news from the Space Force. And regarding Artemis, apparently soon we will know who will actually produce the human landing system to carry out the future moon landings. As always, a lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So the latest update we have from Boca Chica is that Starship SN4 is being stacked in the vehicle assembly building. This means that SN4 is ready for prime time. By the time you watch this video here, it probably already has been transported to the launch pad, where it will undergo the usual tests. Let's hope that this time we won't see any major mistakes. It would be really nice if the cryogenic pressure test with liquefied nitrogen goes well this time. And we cannot wait to see the Raptor engines being installed into Starship. If the pressure test goes well this time, then we will see the wet dress rehearsal, and then finally the hopping test. We remember that last year, SpaceX filed for a permit, which would allow them to perform hopping tests up to a height of 150 meters, as happened with Starhopper. This permit is still valid. Therefore, we could see Starship SN4 perform a hopping test up to 150 meters, should everything go well, as early as May, realistically. May could turn out to be an excellent month for human spaceflight. Not only will Crew Dragon fly its first crewed mission to the ISS, which by the way has now been set to the 27th of May, but we could also see the first hopping tests up to 150 meters with Starship SN4.
At least that's what we hope. Should, however, SN4 also explode or implode, then we can see in these shots here that parts for SN5 and SN6 are ready. The mass production is really happening. Elon said that the hardest part is not building Starship itself, but building the assembly line. Building the machine that builds the machine is really the hardest part. But it looks like mass production of parts for future Starships is steadily increasing in speed. Remember that if we really want to have 1,000 Starships by 2030, as Elon said on numerous occasions will be the goal, we need to ramp up to an output of 2 Starships per week. Currently, we are at 1 Starship every 2 weeks, so another factor 4 increase is needed. However, only a few months ago, remember, it was like 1 Starship per 3 months. So we'd say that this is already quite an improvement, and we think that the target rate of 2 Starships per week is achievable probably by the end of the year or next year at the latest.
By the way, if you are wondering, where should all the money come from to build all these Starships? Well, for one, soon we will see the giant revenue from Starlink rolling in. SpaceX will start to make billions in revenue alone from Starlink per year. By the mid-2020s, SpaceX will make twice NASA's annual budget only with Starlink. But their launch business is also continuing to thrive. Not only has SpaceX beaten all competitors to resupply the future lunar gateway with Dragon XL and Falcon Heavy, a launch contract which is worth a few billion dollars. But no, SpaceX also has the current ISS launch contract with their Crew Dragon and Falcon 9, and future launches for the newly established Space Force, and also up to 12 smallsat rideshare missions with Falcon 9 this year, and also a Falcon Heavy launch in Q4 2020, also for the Space Force, and many more Starlink and Falcon 9 launches, of course. So money-wise, it's looking pretty good for SpaceX, despite the crisis. Therefore, we don't have to worry that the funds for Starship will dry up. But of course, some agencies are extremely unhappy that SpaceX is so successful. Because SpaceX's launch market share is rapidly growing, some others are losing market share. and no one else is losing market share so brutally like the Russian space agency Roscosmos. The chief of Roscosmos, Dmitry Rogozin, accused SpaceX of predatory pricing, or in his own words,
"Instead of honest competition on the market for space launches, they are lobbying for sanctions against us and use price dumping with impunity." We don't even know what to say. This is the funniest shit we've heard in quite some time. It's not that SpaceX has actually been totally neglected by the US government for the longest time and even had to sue the US government because they unfairly awarded launch contracts to Boeing and Lockheed, even though SpaceX is a lot cheaper and more reliable. It's not that SpaceX is able to undercut the price of others because they are using reusable rockets, right? So saying that SpaceX is being subsidized by the US government or NASA is really such an unintelligent remark, to put it mildly. We don't know what to say to that. Actually, we would have quite a few words to describe Rogozin's behavior, but we don't want our video to be demonetized, you know? And just when you thought you have witnessed the pinnacle of human stupidity, the CEO of ULA, yes, the joint company of Boeing and Lockheed, the two most awesome companies on the planet, comes forth and tries to top Rogozin's amazing display of low intelligence. In a recent statement to Aviation Week, the CEO of ULA, Tory Bruno, said that he believes that the economics of reusable rockets is still up for question. He really said that we're not making this up. This here warrants 100% a Picard double face palm. Hey ULA, we have some news for you. Take a look at this. So yeah, just because ULA is absolutely incapable of building reusable rockets, they now want to make reusable rockets appear bad. And SpaceX is, by the way, also totally destroying ULA's launch business. They can shake hands with Roscosmos because they too get totally obliterated by SpaceX. Isn't it funny that the space agencies or companies that get destroyed by SpaceX the most are the ones attacking SpaceX the most? Didn't a very wise person once say, the smallest dog always barks the loudest? Hell, even NASA now chooses SpaceX over Boeing, which is part of ULA, not only for their ISS missions, but also for their future Lunar Gateway resupply missions. Now sure, the ULA will be kept afloat for a while by US taxpayer money and by newly printed stimulus money, but the question is for how long? And as for Russia, with their totally collapsing revenue, we would be surprised if Russia will play any major role in space exploration in the future.
Sure, sometimes they come forth and make some impressive announcements. Actually, they are really good at making announcements. But mark our words, that's all they will ever do. They will have to be 100% subsidized by the Russian government. So by Russian taxpayer money. If they ever want to launch anything, they are losing, shrinking, and they know that they don't have the high ground anymore. Let's be real here. We all know how important it is to have the high ground.
It is over, Roscosmos. I have the high ground. I hate you, SpaceX.
Because Roscosmos lost the high ground to SpaceX a long time ago. Now they increase their aggressive rhetoric and also their aggressive behavior. Let's consult Sun Tzu. If you want to learn something for life, be sure to read Sun Tzu's The Art of War. We can read there, appear weak when you are strong, and strong when you are weak. So currently, Roscosmos certainly wants to appear strong. Even more so with their latest anti-missile test from the 15th of April. To that, General John Raymond, commander of US Space Command and US Space Force Chief of Space Operations, said, "Russia's direct ascent anti-satellite test provides yet another example that the threats to US and allied space systems are real, serious, and growing."
So yes, ladies and gentlemen, we often talk about a future Cold War in space. We personally see a scenario US and allies versus China and allies. And Russia will probably ally itself with China because they don't have enough resources to play any major role on their own. Now, we might not like this scenario, we actually hate it, but we're just trying to be realistic here. The current relations between the US on one side and Russia and China on the other side are deteriorating more and more, and therefore, as we predicted already in the last space report from last week, we think that a new Cold War in space is only a matter of time. Which in itself is not nice, but at least it will greatly accelerate human spaceflight and therefore the colonization of the Moon and Mars. Because the power that will have the best space infrastructure will totally dominate the others. And we think that the Space Force has an absolute ace card with SpaceX's Starship. Starship will enable total space domination for the Space Force. But that's just our theory, you are welcome to disagree. And in order to achieve total space supremacy, the Space Force is now starting to accept applications as soon as from the 1st of May. So feel free to apply, dear viewers. We need the Space Force to grow. We personally can't apply, unfortunately, because we aren't US citizens, and of course we also have to produce all these videos here, you know? So yeah, Space Force, even though not really powerful yet, will be a force to be reckoned with in a few years, we prophesize.
Meanwhile at Artemis, it seems that work on the future human-rated moon lander HLS, which stands for Human Landing Systems, is going on despite the crisis. We remember that last year, NASA asked all participant companies to submit their proposals for a lunar lander by November. Three industry teams have submitted HLS proposals. One is led by Blue Origin, who has partnered with Draper, Lockheed Martin, and Northrop Grumman. Boeing also submitted a proposal. Dynetics, not to be confused with Dianetics, teamed up with Sierra Nevada Corporation for the third proposal. There is strong suspicion that SpaceX also submitted a proposal, but SpaceX never confirmed this. Of course, with the behemoth Starship, which would put all other lunar landers to shame. So later this month, NASA will finally reveal which team will be rewarded the contract to build the lunar lander. Certainly, we will talk about this in one of our future videos, as soon as the announcement is made.
So what do you think? Who won the stupidity contest? Roscosmos or ULA?
And do you agree with us that SpaceX will have enough money to build 1,000 starships?
Maybe even 1,004? So you just watched the JS Space Report, which we do twice per week. On Mondays we talk about the most recent news and developments, and on Fridays we explain some questions about spaceflight related topics. Currently we talk about fixing the flaws of Starship to overcome certain problems like zero G and cosmic rays.
So be sure to turn on the notification bell so that you don't miss the Friday episode.
So then I would say see you next time and on to the future!